Welcome to the STABcast, a podcast dedicated to Star Wars Legion.
Well, we'll let the fate decide, huh? I just happen to have a chance cube here.
Welcome, cadets and commanders, to STABcast, the Sunsphere Tactical Attack Brigade's Star Wars Legion podcast. I'm Tim, the Dice Hate Me Hannon, joined by Ben, Dice Swing Worse Than a Suburban Key Party, Fowler, and Ryan, Ridiculous Dice Don't Happen Unless They Happen to Me, Soloski. Will is gone due to beating us all in TI and Great Western Trail and has thus been banished.
It was my birthday, Tim. My birthday! And he beat me on my birthday!
He beat the birthday boy, and not in a good way. It's very sad.
So he's banished! Banished.
I just sat in the corner with my four little planets and kind of.
Actually,
I just played the spoiler and I stopped Ben from winning and tried to stop Will from winning.
Oh, what a hero, Ryan! What a hero!
I was.
He stopped me from winning, allowing Will to win. So
I also attacked Will's home system, mind you. I was the only one to do so.
So it looked as though Ryan was going to do a hard left, run right into Will, but instead he chose the emergency surprise, punched Tim square in the face.
For no reason.
Tim, who was in last place.
Who had, you know, nearly a half the galaxy, yeah. You're
but
right.
It was half the galaxy did not equal half the victory points, though.
Exactly.
No, but your planets would have equaled the victory points that I needed.
I don't know what you're talking about.
So if you want to listen to our Twilight Imperium podcast, we'll be launching that next week.
somebody finally gets mad at me when I stop playing the point police and try to win myself.
Yeah, so if you listen to our first podcast of that one, you definitely find out that Ryan does not play the point police. He's often in the lead and then complains when we try to stop him from doing it.
Correct.
Things.
This is correct.
Yes.
I don't complain. Ben just shifts blame to everyone else.
That's what we all do. That's what we all do to cover our failures.
It's because normally I'm winning, and that's how you win.
That's how we all cover our own inaptitude.
It's all about the winning. And when you're in the lead, as I often am early in the game, I have to distract people from the fact that I'm not really winning until I win.
Next game, we're all going to support for the throne each other except for Ryan.
Hold on. This is also Ben who only wins when he sits next to the new guy.
I sat next to Will and Tim and still nearly won that game. It really came down to the very end.
True.
Will and I were very close on this one.
This week on STABcast, some battle reports, a look at specialists, a conversation about dice, and much, much more.
Ryan and I got together Wednesday before, and Ryan needs some practice. He's going to a special event there in St. Louis. He needs to see, can he put a hit on the droids there? So I said, sure, I'll bring my boys out, get out to the table.
I've had zero games against droids at this point.
Zero games.
So, zero.
And so we end up playing key positions, major offensive, and clear conditions. Now, I can hear you, audience. You know how I personally rail against clear conditions.
Yes.
It was my battle deck.
You were blue.
I chose clear conditions. Boo. And my problem is, as a droid player, I cannot give up the unit to go put him into the backfield. I can't have my rapid reinforcements. I can't afford to lose that one set of guys. Hmm. My dice are too inconsistent for me to be able to pull that off.
Right, and Rapid was in our first column.
Yeah, Rapid was in our first column, so I got rid of it. Hostile, I was actually would have been okay with if it had come up. I don't believe it did. No. And I think we were jockeying more for position and the deployment than we were for anything else.
Correct, yes.
I think Minefield was on there. I think Minefield was on there. So that's where we ended up with clear conditions. Like I said, I do feel bad about it, but I currently don't have the units I would like to be able to drop in the backfield in order to pull that off. Once I get maybe B2s, maybe if I get two sets of those in the list, I'll go get clear conditions back out.
But. B2s are coming, and I think they're going to be awesome.
I'm terrified of B2s, but also excited a little bit to see them played.
The map that Ryan and I built, because we built it, I was trying to get there early. Traffic jams happened. I have to cross town. I arrive at the game store at like 6:45. I had left work an hour and 15 minutes beforehand, but that's fine.
Yep, sounds about right.
Knoxville, you're killing me. We set up a table very quickly. It isn't the greatest table of things, and I'm very worried about cover with droids. Droids get blown to pieces. Like, they don't roll much of a defense dice. They don't surge to anything. Mm-hmm. So if they don't have cover, if you can't take away a couple of those hits, you're going to lose lots of guys very quickly. And so I deploy on this little grassy knoll that I have access to. Yeah, I know. Tim's eyes got real big at that. I deployed on the grassy knoll, and our key position is a little barn directly in front of me. It is a little rock that Ryan has very close to his side, and a kind of tower in the dead center. A little off-center, but again, that's really the center there. Ryan decides he's going to put Luke and some troopers on the near the big target because they can move fast, because I think he's got recon intel on everything for some reason.
Yeah, I had 4 copies of recon intel on my list.
Oh, gross. He's got an FD cannon because, of course he does, mm-hmm. Which now shoots at range 5, which hits everything on my side of the board just because it does.
It was pretty rad.
It was everywhere. Let's see. You've got a mortar, and you've got the four block dice. Yeah, the Mark II. Thank you. You've got some stuff going on there, and I'm running my straight up patented. When I say patented, it's one of the two lists you can really kind of run.
Yes, there are two CIS lists right now.
It was 2 droidicas, not 3, and I sunk all the rest of the points in all the upgrades. So it was fully manned list of all the things with the EC because I really love that guy. Those 3 black dice and even your dice pool out really well.
He brings some nice consistency.
Oh, nice consistency. I mean, which is mostly 1, but it's still at least it's consistent. but it's Grievous, it's aggressive tactics, it's strict orders. I line up against a Ryan there. Very first thing, he and I are both very cagey. There's a lot of, take a thing. Standby is not going to do worth a whole lot, so I barely move. I try not to get off the hill, or if I do, I get off the hill, so I'm right behind the barn so that the FD laser cannon cannot shoot me in the face.
Yeah, I don't know. Were you, in hindsight, were you more afraid of Pizza Gun than you probably should have been?
I was more afraid of Pizza Gun, but if Pizza Gun can light up, which it can, you aim and then you fire, and then I lose 5 dudes, then you're going to go shoot the other full health unit, which is coming around the corner in a second. So I lost 5 dudes there, and now I'm down to 2 units of 3 dudes.
Well, and it almost starts to feel like, with the new range increase, which I think is needed, don't get me wrong, it feels like a lot of times, like, the Pizza Gun's almost like Rebels' version of the AT-ST in the sense of, like, wow, it's really scary when it hits hard.
Yes,
but
absolutely.
It's only going to shoot me 6 times at most. At most. And that's probably pushing it, but...
So the problem is Ryan's FD laser cannon is looking at the broadside of that barn. Mm-hmm. And so his boys can just line up on the other side and we can just all hug the barn together.
Yes.
But he's going to outscore me in points. And sure. I have to cross the death field to get to the giant tower where I also mm-hmm. need to score those points. Because mm-hmm. I was just going to let Ryan have his side. But
The tricky part was, we didn't use a third of the map, really half the map. I deployed the last key position as the red player. To kind of force a cagey battle since I had Luke and Chewbacca.
And I'll be honest, I would do the same thing. I would have put mine exactly where you put yours.
And as a CIS player or as a Rebel player?
Both. Okay. Because I can stand on that point and shoot at the other target.
Yeah. You had better cover in your deployment zone. I had better cover outside of mine. So you choosing when to step out of your cover was definitely the tricky part.
Yep, absolutely. So I leave Grievous to be my last, but I only have so many activations. And then, for some reason, this Z6 turns around this corner. Grievous takes 5 hits.
From an unmodified Z6 shot, yeah.
Dice are never really bad, Tim, unless they're bad.
That's right. That's right.
I rolled all blank red dice. It was a...
Crazy dice don't happen unless they happen to me.
My dice were pretty hot garbage up until that point. I think you got the early dice advantage, Ben, but then that kind of turned the game on its head.
Yeah, and that really was round 2.
Yeah, no, Grievous took a big hit that he really shouldn't have.
Took a real, real bad heavy hit. So I have to make a decision. Am I going to try to get real defensive and let my dudes guardian? The problem with that is that my little dudes have to go first to get out there so they can take the guardian shots. They're going to get shot at by Ryan's people, losing more guys, and then they have to be able to also take the Grievous shot. So I decided to go super offensive with Grievous. If I'm going to die, let us die valiantly, and let's go destroy as many things as we possibly can.
Didn't you only get 2 attacks off of your 1 pip?
I did, but what Ryan is willfully misremembering is that second one is I killed Chewbacca with it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No.
So it was a... Yeah. Exactly. It was worth the death. Since Grievous was going to die anyway, I managed to take out a unit and take out Chewbacca at the same time. Right. Mm. Now, Chewbacca did get caught in a place I don't think Ryan was expecting. He did dance like a puppet on those bullets. Pop, pop, pop,
pop, pop, pop. Yeah, yeah. Chewie took 5 hits kind of out of nowhere. Like, he was going to get when he came out of my bag and where I grabbed him. Chewie was in a really good spot. He was only going to get shot once, maybe twice. But he ended up taking way more damage than I had really anticipated him to, because the dice just lit up in a way you don't expect. I want to say, did you throw like 6 hits into Chewbacca with one B1 squad?
No, I got 4. Okay. But still, because I shot you 3 times with those units. I mean, I still managed to get 5 hits across, you know, 3 B1 units.
So Chewie and heavy cover took quite a bit of damage. But I mean, it is what it is, and Chewie bought me time, and he did his job. And I'll trade Chewie for a Grievous all day, every day.
Oh yeah, oh absolutely. So,
On the one flank that we're not really paying attention to, Luke is over there being KGs. I'll get out. These Z6 are kind of popping around corners and shooting things. But I leave a set of Droidicas just outside of range 5, so that the FD laser cannon cannot shoot them. But I can shoot Luke, and I get some nice damage on him. I get I think at half health.
Mm-hmm.
But then Grievous dies. Luke comes out of hiding from around that corner of that rock. He puts a hurt on some Droidicas in a bad way. We both play our one pips, and I'm praying for the dice roll, and I don't get it. So Luke gets to go first. So I don't get any extra damage with the Droidicas. I don't even get him close to death, because there's a chance that I manage to knock him out right there. Yeah, Droidicas are dead. And then so Luke starts screaming on my flank there into turn 4. It's going to be real, real bad when the game continues. And then what happens with droids, I mean, once Grievous is dead, your bubble collapses, and you take more than 2 suppression, and you're panicked.
Yep.
And so the problem is, it feels real bad using a 200-point model as a defensive measure. He's just going to hide behind this rock to make sure I have a bubble.
It sounds like you need a Dooku.
I mean, he does hide, and he doesn't. I don't think, honestly, anything went wrong with your Grievous play. I think that I got some lucky hits through. I think maybe you hide him one more turn just so you can double move and get a charge. And you wait for me to come a little closer to you. But other than that, I think you activated him just maybe 1 or 2 activations too early. Or brought him around that corner.
How many games have you had against droids, Ryan?
2.
Oh, nice. Okay.
I'm talking about in our specific circumstance.
Oh, I see. Okay. I think
you brought him around 1 turn too early.
Fair enough.
Because I think if you can get him tied up in melee, he's perfectly safe. 8 hit points in melee with somebody as fast as he is can jump from engagement to engagement.
Hmm. I had done enough damage on one flank. There weren't a lot of units over there anyway, and the other guys were so far away, and that FD really did hold the middle lane.
No, it did.
I had one unit panic when they really didn't need to, and again, that one dice roll makes a difference. We had a couple. That's how close the game was. Like, I'm not saying it was a blowout, because it really wasn't. No. That's good. How close the game itself was. So if I had gotten initiative on that turn where Luke got to go first, there's a chance that I kill Luke, or at least put him on 1 health, and you really have to think about where you go with him next.
Yeah, the funny thing about that game was we played 4 turns, if I'm remembering correctly.
Yeah, 4 rounds, yep.
Because the store was closing. I think you win if we play 5, and I think I win if we play 6.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, I think that's the way that happens.
Interesting. I wish I had seen that.
Like I said, if I don't panic, I had a full unit panic. Because he Jedi mind tricked me.
Gross.
And it's one of those. mind trick's pretty rad, yo.
Yeah, it's almost like he knew he was playing against droids. I don't know.
Hold on, I'd played that exact same list at 2 tournaments previous.
Because you're looking for droids. No. No, like I said, and if I had just managed to clear just a single suppression, I was okay. But right. I couldn't clear the suppression.
That's gross.
And so I saw my guy, a full unit, just panic. They didn't panic off the board, but they had to panic and run, which actually moved them closer to Luke, which was bad.
Yeah. I don't know. Mind trick seems like real value right now.
Yeah.
For people who are going to be going up, like if you're going to go to a tournament and you think there's going to be some prequel spam, which I think we can expect to see with the shiny new toys for a little while. Because they've only got one commander option and they don't have bravery 2 backup options. So if I can just have a panic on demand, that seems pretty good.
I don't know. Will you see them? Because according to the internet, nobody can put together the B1 battle droids. So now, I say that as a man who has not put together a B1 battle droid. I definitely outsource that to Wilhelm the Banished. So
yes. So we'll see. But no, I think Mind Trick's really quite strong right now.
Ryan, you and I play that game. Like I said, I lose it, but it was a good, tight, close game.
Yeah,
and
it was
like,
a good game.
I need more droids. Somebody else, come down to the store. Challenge me.
So after playing, once again, there are two CIS lists, the double droidica or the triple droidica. I got to play Landon the next Wednesday at local store, and he brought the three droidica variety. And I was playing the exact same list. So Luke, Leia, Chewie, a set of vets, a Mark II, a pizza cannon, three rebel troopers, one with a medic, and the two just are six-man Z6 squads. And man, did I get screwed on deployment. My deployment zone was not particularly great, especially for a pizza cannon. I set the table up because I got there a little earlier, and so for casual play, if you build the table, I think you should let your opponent pick board edge. I let Blandon pick board edge, but we use, I think, my battle deck, or anyway. We end up playing intercept the transmissions with hostile environment and major offensive. And all the terrain on my board edge was placed in a way that I couldn't have a great spot for my pizza cannon. There was no awesome place for me to like put it up against a piece of cover. I either needed to give it a great firing lane, but it's out in the open and pretty close to the center point, or it's going to get heavy cover from everything, but it's going to give heavy cover to everything. And that was a tough spot to be. Hmm. So I ended up putting it on top of a building where it could see the middle point pretty clearly. But that's really the only impactful area it could see.
And we've discussed this before.
Yes.
I love the laser cannon when it works beautifully. But does that feel like, oh, there's 70 points I didn't need to waste?
I mean, obviously those 70 points being like a Z6 squad would have probably, in that particular map, done me better. But that range 5 threat is really nice, especially when he's got to death walk his blob of dudes into capture the middle point. Because Landon was running, you know, three droidicas, one Grievous, and six B1s, but the B1s were not kitted out. I think he only had three of the special guns of the heavy weapons, two HQ uplinks, and then one just six-man team. So he was missing some of the upgrades. They weren't fully kitted B1s. But I send Luke along the long edge of the board to try to kind of wrap around and go contest his back point. Because on intercept and major offensive, you have one of your points that's very easy to defend. I had my medic squad babysitting mine, who on the odd number turns would run up, heal somebody, and then run back to the even number turns to score. And Luke takes a risky position turn one. I only get shot at once, I spend my dodge token, and I take one damage. I was like, okay, I can live with this. Turn two, Luke runs into some cover, but closer to more bad guys. And Landon kind of ignores him, but does manage to get one big hit off on him. And with a set of B1s with Luke in heavy cover, manages to put four wounds on him. So cool. Luke is now on two.
That's gross.
But Luke is now in a spot, once I activate him, where I can jump over a piece of terrain and either engage with a set of destroyer droids and then be really close to another, or I can double move into his infantry blob, because he is moving all of his infantry blob onto the middle point, which was covered in difficult terrain but light cover. And to Landon's credit, he's the only person in a really long time that the way the terrain came out and the way Landon decided to play it, he outscored me on the first score of intercept. And that doesn't happen to me a lot. Nice. Because I tend to play... I decided to stay back because I had to... I kind of was in the Ben predicament of last game, where I had some great cover in my deployment zone, but to get out on the map, I had to step into some open terrain and spend a turn there, and when there's a onslaught of B1s and three destroyer droids, I wasn't sure I really wanted to do that. And so Luke's in position. I've kind of got everybody where I want him to be. Grievous is leading the charge of his B1s, and he ends his move. Landon's last activation was Grievous taking a pot shot with his Annihilator onto Leia. She passes a couple hits off, but I think takes two herself. But he just shot me at range two. And I'm running Luke, Leia, Chewbacca.
Oh, no. I know where this is going. Oh.
So I throw Brains and Brawn. Wah, wah, wah. He throws his... You actually don't know where this is going. I throw Brains and Brawn, and he throws Grievous's 2-pip. And he wins the roll-off.
Ooh.
Now, Landon made a big mistake. And we talked about this, and it's because he's still new with droids. and he was treating his destroyer droids like speeder bikes, where you don't want to commit them too early, and you put them in the back. No. So it took him almost two and a half turns to get them where he needed to. No. I think between his three destroyers, he took 5 ball form turns.
Treat them like E-Webs. Destroyers.
Because they're ground vehicles, and he didn't want to displace all of his guys.
Sure.
Sure. So I definitely like to deploy my guys in front so that my B1s can walk behind them in cover.
Yeah.
Yes.
Let them be your shield.
And I think he learned that. Yeah. I think he learned that. He was thinking that he could ball form and treat them like bikes and get them into position that way. And it didn't quite work out. But anyway, so he's got his one set of destroyers to where they can take a speed one move and then shoot Luke in his little hidey hole. Now, because I played Brains and Brawn, Luke has no tokens. Luke is exposed, and Luke is on, I think, 2 or 3 wounds. And he throws 5 hits, and Luke rolls 2 blocks, and Luke expires. Oh. So all Luke did for me this game, my 180-point Luke, was he absorbed 3 shots. Like, if I lose a Luke, that's okay. As long as he takes some heat, but I really don't feel like he took enough heat this game. Like, 2 B1 shots and 1 destroyer droid shot, no. I don't think is enough tank. So I was a little frustrated, but then I get to pull Brains and Brawn onto Grievous. And me and Landon talked, was that the right call, or was it... I personally think he should have charged Grievous into Leia, because he was range 2.
Mm-hmm.
So he could have made that charge and diced her up. Now, he would have ran away from his B1s. So, and then that would have potentially let Luke activate, although I have to pull a token for Luke. But it turns off Brains and Brawn.
But I think, I was just going to say, I think I still, in that situation, I think I'd still go after Leia and just try and, like you said, try and cut her up and just think about what that would do for me.
Yeah, and I think it's Landon was trying to juggle so many things in his head. Like, his plan was setting up, I'm going to murder Luke,
right?
And I'm going to play Grievous's 2-pip to take a defensive stance. And so I think he just kind of got a little one-tracked mind and saw blood in the water and went for it. And he got Luke for it, so it's not all bad for him.
Because Grievous in a one-on-one with Leia can absolutely murder her. And so now you're down 2 commanders on this turn.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I definitely, because you know you're going to Brains and Brawn, that bad boy.
So yeah, I pop, Leia pulls an aim token, drops Brains and Brawn, I let it fly. Now, he did play Grievous' 2-pip, so he gets to kind of, anything that's not a crit, he does parcel away at his robot boys.
Right.
I don't think Landon, until turn 3 or 4, until turn 3 and we got to play all 6, he never picked up his white defense dice and didn't get at least 1 block. It was the dumbest thing I've ever seen. Just like, pick up 2 white block dice, no surge tokens, and just throw them, block. Pick up 3 white dice, throw them, block. I was like, come on, man.
Well,
come on.
Normally, I was about to say, what happens with me is there's 7 hits for some reason. So I just have to pick up 7 white dice, so I should get 1 block out of that.
Yeah, no, Len, it was silly. It was silly. He had a B1 squad roll better odds than Luke did. It was
so
funny.
So you're saying bad dice doesn't happen until it happens.
Bad, yeah, right. Exactly.
That's right. Weird dice aren't a thing until they're a thing for me.
My pizza cannon's doing some raining fire. Grievous takes a few hits from Brains and Bronze, but I basically make the executive decision to ignore his destroyers and just kill all the B1s, because he's got the triple destroyer, which means there's less B1s. And at the top of turn 5, I've got him down to Grievous and 5 roly or and 6 roly boys. And I managed to knock him off of his back point for the second score, putting me up 3-2 going in. We did get to play all 6 turns, and it basically meant he had to either table me or, during the final score, be the only one to score.
Mm,
right. And he couldn't quite manage that. The game ended with Grievous having 5 wounds on him and there being 5 destroyer droids on the table. And I think I had 7 rebel troopers and a pizza cannon.
Mm.
I had 7 troopers. I think it was probably less than that. But yeah, it was an absolute bloodbath. But I think
it's one of those, and again, I remember learning how to play bikes. It was very difficult. They were either in the midst of everything or they were too far back.
I mean, they're still,
so those roly boys had gotten there a turn earlier.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the difference in that game.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, no, I definitely think him misplaying his droids definitely helped me quite a bit. Once again, Luke not getting to pop really, only Luke card I got to pop. I'm less mad about losing Luke and his lightsaber. I'm kind of more disappointed I never got to use his cards because right. I only played my ally.
Yeah.
I mean, same in our game, I only ever played Grievous's one pip. Everything else was a generic.
Yeah, no, that's true. Yeah. So that game could have gone either way if Landon would have deployed his destroyers a little forward. That also meant Luke could have gotten to them a turn sooner, because that's the way I kind of like to, with that list anyway, I like to approach CIS games, is I want Chewbacca to go and engage Grievous.
Right.
Because, you know, you not getting a free surge to crit is pretty cool. And Luke going to destroyer droids and saying, I don't care about your shields, is pretty helpful. And then whoever's going to win that infantry war, I think Rebel Troopers, thanks to Nimble, will probably come out a little bit ahead, but I think it all kind of also comes down to the Z6/B1 gun and where the spike happens. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I know I've got two games against Angry Cyborg Man under my belt, and it's a different army to play against than I thought it might be. They're cool.
I'm kind of sad. I've not gotten to play against droids all that much. I've seen a lot of droid games. I've watched a lot of. I've observed a lot. I just haven't gotten to play against a lot. I think I've played
Tim,
one.
You strike me deep.
I know.
Yes, you played against me, Tim. You played against me.
Yeah. I think that's about it. I don't think. Maybe I've played against one more.
It was a very memorable game. That lizard just danced on my droidicas, and I couldn't do anything about it.
I still love me some Dubecks, even if they're not here yet.
So, all right. So, Tim, we've been playing. What have you been playing?
Well, I've been playing a little bit. I was on vacation for a while, so I missed out on many a game, both online and real life. But I'm still in the Invader League early stages. And by in it, I mean I am contractually mandated to play games in it.
Yes.
But, spoiler alert, I'm 0-3, so I'm not really in it.
So you're the Cleveland Browns of the Invader League.
Yes. It's quite.
That's where the Stabcast usually kind of lies.
That's true. Listen, sometimes my Baker Mayfield shows up, and I can really just throw it in there, and you're like, maybe he's got it. Maybe he's coming back. This is going to be his season. And then you're like, oh wait, it's the Browns. So very much so. That's a very apt description.
I'm curious. So between the Yavin based team league and the Invader League. What is your personal record, Tim?
Oh, I don't know. I don't keep track. I just have fun. Because if
I'm
keep
track...
I'm
pretty sure that means he hasn't won a game.
If I keep track, I'll be set. No. Actually, in Last Invader, I did pretty good. I think...
You won two games in the Yavin race.
Yeah, I was 2-3. I think I was 2-3 in the first Invader I played. And it's similar in the Yavin base one, I think. No, okay. Yavin base was a little bit worse, I think. But anyway, yeah, I've mostly lose, but I can get some wins in there. You know.
I won 2 in the last Yavin base league.
Yeah, but. Exactly. Yes.
Didn't the two games you won in Yavin base, Ben? Didn't you guys just play Yahtzee? Wasn't it just like? Didn't you win the droid v droid games, which is essentially Yahtzee?
I chose the beefier droid list, which allowed me to survive the hits that came at me. To weather those hits.
Leave Ben alone. He did fine. There we go. As the ex-team captain who probably will never get that title again.
Team captain. So, yeah. So, Tim, when I pass, it will not be like Boromir. I will not follow you anywhere, my brother, my captain.
That's right. That's right.
You are Faramir. There are days I wish you had gone first.
So, I played against... his name on Discord is Nash J, but I believe that's Nima. I could be wrong. Because when he came up on the TTS, it came up as Nima, so I could be wrong, but officially Nash J. But anyway, it was an interesting game. He was trying something new, I was trying something new for me. I finally, you know, we've talked about it on the show before, I finally got a chance to try Operative Vader, which we'll get into in a moment. It was interesting. And then he was trying something a little bit different, where he had Leia Sabine triple Tauntauns.
Okay.
Two snipers, no Z6s whatsoever, and then some. He had some recon intels on a couple of folks. So, interesting list. And I had on my end, I had Operative Vader, Krennic, three Shores, which again, I'll discuss that in a moment, two DLT stormtroopers, only one mortar, and then two snipers.
Okay.
Which
I like both those lists. Yeah, I've got to ask, did he have no Z6s because he just wanted more rebel bodies?
I don't. He had 11 activations. It was 10 versus 11.
Okay. Yeah, triple tauntaun for rebels gets surprise. Real expensive.
Yeah, I think it was just points trimming, and that's where he wanted the bodies with the tauntauns, which worked out well for him, honestly. Because if he hadn't have done that, he would have lost probably. But he did real good with it.
Well, I also like your list, Tim. I really do.
Yeah. Well, we can talk about that now. So I talked to him about this after the game. And we had a good discussion about the Shore, I guess you could say Shore meta, the Shore, I wouldn't say so much meta, but like the obsession with Shore troopers. And I think they're really good. I think they're
strong.
Yeah, I think they're really strong. I don't agree with the one for one with mortars.
No.
Simply because that takes up a trooper slot. And that is so crucial. And every game I've played where if I try and do double mortar, double Shore, even if my mortars don't die, which normally my mortars live, but all they do is shoot three white dice once a round, and that's it. They can't claim objectives. I mean, unless it's key positions, but still, like, they're just not useful enough to me to take up that tactical swat that I just need that fill of troopers. Because especially when you're playing against Tauntauns, they're going to get shredded. And so you need all the bodies you can get.
A DLT Stormtrooper is hard to replace.
Right. Well, and but again, a Shore Trooper, the nice thing with Shore Troopers, and again, we talked about this before, is that with their expensive extra long distance gun guy, at range 3, you're still throwing 5 dice, 3 of which are black dice, which is, and crit 1. It's not bad.
Right.
Not bad at all. So even when you get reduced down to that, they're still really scary. And you can still, my goodness, I actually think I don't know if I wiped a squad, but I came real close to wiping a squad with a guy that was down to bare bones. So they can still do damage, which is nice. But anyway, so I'm really on this camp of more Shores, less mortars.
Sure.
Men over mortars.
Looking at the Shore Troopers with the heavy weapons, just those two is 84 points for 5 models, while a DLT Storm is 68. Is it worth that it's worth the 14 point upcharge?
Yes.
Or no, excuse me, gosh. Yeah, 14 points.
Yes. I think so, because again, when you're getting down to it, I think the math works out a little bit better. I think they're better, but again, that's not me dissing DLT Storms either. I love them. But yeah, so 3 Shores, 2 DLTs was a really nice, and it's nice to have a mortar in there if nothing else for suppression. It's nice. I'm not against it.
Is the mortar worth it if you're not playing a suppression list?
Yeah.
The only list that I've really had troubles with mortars is when it was like double mortar, double death trooper. And it was just like all the suppressive weapons.
See, everywhere. You say that. I think you're the only person I've ever heard say that kind of thing. Mortars are always there. They're always something you have to think about because they're still going to be dealing out enough suppression to at least slow you down and at least make you think about things. I don't think you have to build a suppression list just to run mortars. And again, crit 1 on them works out really well.
Especially if you
can fire support them, then you're getting crit 2 with those Shores, which is pretty sweet. But anyway, and then Operative Vader. So playing Darkness Descends, which was probably my more interesting thing, it was really intriguing having a 11 activation list versus a 10 activation list, mine being the 10 activation, but Vader still goes last. So it's almost for deployment reasons, it doesn't matter that he had more activations, which I liked. I liked that I could go under and still go last with my arguably most important deployment.
That is interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a really cool thing that I didn't even realize. So we started putting troopers down. And I was like, oh, he goes last, like not just last for me, but he's the last unit placed. Which is kind of cool. It's kind of cool workaround for some other things. More tactical and smarter people than me could figure out how to work that around. He had a lot of recon intel, like I said. And so...
Did that cause a problem for Darkness Descends?
It did. It wasn't crippling by any means, but it definitely made me less efficient than I would have liked to have been. It made me put Vader where I didn't necessarily want him, but, I mean, I had to put him where I could. So he wasn't in my deployment, but he wasn't as, like, far forward as I would have liked him to be. But it still worked out. Oh, and also Vader, I should note, had Overwatch on him, which I didn't super use it, but the threat of it, I think, was really interesting because he saw it immediately and commented on it. And so he knew at any time I could do standby and then trigger that and then do all kinds of goofy things with that. And so I like it a lot. I think I know it's hard to give up that one red die, but having that ability to put Vader on standby and his trigger at range 3. I know he can't attack at range 3, but still lets him do his old tricks and stuff.
Yeah, get a move in.
Yeah. Hmm.
That's interesting. Let's unpack that for a second.
I was thinking, huh.
Yeah.
So were you using it to retreat backwards?
I didn't, but I used, again, he had Tauntauns, so his Tauntauns were coming in, and there's at one point where I had a decision to make of, do I put Vader on standby or do I not? Now, the only reason why I didn't was because he had already gone a few units ahead and already put some of his guys on standby, and basically Vader would have been walking into a meat grinder for that turn.
Sure.
So it wasn't beneficial that turn to do it. But it was a really nice tactical option to have, to know I didn't have to push Vader if I didn't want to, because I could put him in that situation to where it's almost like priming the pump. Like, the pump is primed, it's ready to go, but I don't have to do it. I can step away and say, hey, you know what? You trigger him if you want to.
Sure. How much does that build lose against Imperial lists? Against a list with more range 4 options can still play around that. Like, obviously in the Invader League, you know you're playing against a Rebel,
Rebel list. Yeah, it's definitely something I brought because I knew I was playing Rebels, and I figured I'd be playing Tauntauns. Safe bet.
A safe bet.
Yeah, I'm the only Imperial player in my entire group. That's neat. So I knew I'm always going to be playing against Rebels, which is very sad, but it's the way it goes. It's different. It's different.
Why
it's
not Endurance? I'm just asking questions. I'm not saying you're wrong. I just love that card.
No, that's a great question. And I did go back and forth with Endurance on there. He didn't really mind the suppression that much. It was never an issue. So I think that was the right call as far as not bringing that. He actually always liked a little bit of suppression. Again, it was a situation where my opponent had to be really careful about, do I shoot Vader with just a shot to take a shot at him? But it's going to give him suppression and probably not do any damage. And the other nice thing, it shouldn't be understated, is with Darkness Descends, is those two surge tokens. That's pretty sweet, too.
On turn one, yeah.
Yeah.
That's fair.
That's really good. And especially, again, with that extra standby, if I wanted to give him a standby, which I didn't, but if I had, it was a cool workaround for that.
I just think, did you never... With Spur being an ability to take on suppression yourself, did you ever not Spur when you otherwise might have wanted to because of the fear of losing an action?
I Spurred once.
Okay.
And then the Tauntauns were there.
Okay. Once again, I guess if you know you're playing Tauntauns,
Yeah, I Spurred once and I never had to again. So that's why I didn't do it, because I knew that was going to be the case. Unless something crazy happened, I knew that was going to be the case. So I was like, well, I'm not worried about suppression.
Did you get the turn one attack off with Vader? Like, because of placement, did you get the turn one attack off on Vader?
Did I get to attack turn one? I'm trying to recall. I think... No. I don't think so. I don't think they quite got there in time. Maybe I did.
Honestly, that's probably a good thing for Vader, because if Vader can attack, that means he's way too close to everyone.
Yeah, I was going to say, no, I didn't, because I remember I got shot. But again, he actually rolled really well that turn, so I didn't have to worry about using my surge tokens. But no, turn one I got shot, and then maybe it might have been at the end of turn one I might have gotten the hit off. I'm not sure. But he did really good, even Operative Vader. Let's talk about that for a minute. Operative Vader did really good holding his own against those Tauntauns. Great counter to him, because you have to pay attention to Vader. It's Vader. Mm-hmm. And since he's forward deployed a little bit, he's there. He's in your line. And he closed in around Vader a little bit, which set me up really good for turn two Master of Evil, which worked out really well. I think I hit like five or six units with it, which is really good. All three of his Tauntauns got hit with it, which is really effective. One of his Tauntauns actually panicked, and we discussed this. We didn't realize it when I did it, but the way the map was set up, when we looked at it from the angle of trying to figure out what was closest board edge, there's actually like a step up, because my guys were up on a cliff, and there's actually a step up onto the cliff, and so technically, legally, he had to retreat up the cliff and right into the middle of all my guys. And so he displaced a whole bunch of my guys, which is really funny. It wasn't either of our intentions. It just happened that way. But
and the gross thing with that is that they have to reposition if it makes it a better thing for them.
Yeah.
I mean,
it was funny. So he did that. Vader held his own. I will say, Operative Vader, I'm not sold on him simply because you miss that extra red die. And you, more than that, you miss those two extra hit points. Because turn three, his Tauntauns have been taking quite a beating. They're down, I think he's down one. One unit is down to one model. The other one's down to two models, but one's like got three damage on or something like that. So they're hurting. They're hurting bad and doing good. And my trooper's right behind Vader, so they're doing good. Short troopers are doing their thing. I am placable turn three. Get some good hits off, kill another Tauntaun. I'm still in melee, so I'm still protected. I was hoping to kill one more, do a little bit more damage, but I just couldn't punch through. Vader gets hit, and he goes down by one hit. And he already been med-botted once. I had a med-bot with me, by the way. Goes down. He dies, and then the next token I pull, of course, is the implacable redistributed token. And my opponent, bless his heart, was even like, you don't have an operative. Where's your operative? And then, like, as he was saying, he wasn't being mean. Salt. No, he wasn't being mean at all. He was like, oh, I'm so sorry. It's okay. Oh. And it was a case in point where that one extra hit, or those two extra hit points, rather, really would have, like, I don't know if it would have swung the game for a reason I'm about to explain, but versus Tauntauns, I would have been able to probably wipe the Tauntauns. The beauty of having Vader and the way this list was set up, I wasn't super scared of them, and they were really efficient distraction. But they didn't do... They killed Vader, but they died killing Vader. The problem, again, was the distraction factor, so I couldn't get past them. So we played Recover the Supplies. I couldn't move fast enough to get the boxes away from him. So his Tauntauns came in, held the front line, with a couple, right. I think he had a trooper or two that were up there too, and then Leia and another trooper grabbed the boxes and ran. And that was...
Yeah.
I couldn't... And it became a factor of, I have the firepower at the end of the game. I think we stopped around four. I had enough firepower to kill him. I had the bodies. I just didn't have the speed. I couldn't catch him. And there was just no way. And then on the other side of the map, it should be... I mean, Sabine did Sabine things. He deployed her kind of by herself, and she, very heroically, quote-unquote, took on a sniper unit, and man, she punched that sniper unit in the face, and he punched her back, and then they went back and forth, and that was pretty much Sabine's game. She wrestled with a snout trooper for the entire game, and that's it.
Was it Darksaber Sabine?
No.
I was about to say,
but she got a box out of it, so
yeah,
she got the box, okay. So she did her job. So it's just a matter of I didn't have the speed to take him down.
Sure.
But it was really interesting. No, really, really interesting.
I mean, that's the one edge us rebels get is we tend to be a little more sprightly.
Well, and it was curious too. Had things worked out a little bit different dice wise, which I'm not at all blaming dice. It worked out just fine mathematically speaking. But if I just got swung a little bit better, I thought about doing Vader's might, because he factored in the fact that I had force push on Vader. He forgot about Vader's might, and so I could have pushed both Tauntauns off of me and shot both of them, because I had a unit of short troopers and the DLT right there to shoot them.
That's all.
Okay. So it would have been... That's where Vader's might comes into play, of having a double push. Yeah. Double push.
And that sounds awesome.
Pretty good. Again, it didn't work out that way, but it was definitely... I had it in my digital hand ready to go, and I said, no, not this time. But yeah, it was good. That's a really long... One of my longer battle reports, but is a lot of new things.
Sure, no, it's new stuff. And
yeah.
Is Implacable an auto-occlude on Op Vader?
No. For me, my playstyle, probably yes, but I can definitely understand people not taking it.
Okay.
I can definitely understand people not taking it.
Did you take both of Vader's one pips?
Most of his other one pip, I can't. Yeah. Yeah, because Vader's might. Yeah.
In my actual play with Vader as commander, I had stopped using Implacable. Because I always found that I was always that one hit point shy, and I didn't know if it was worthwhile. Or I played Implacable to get the one pip,
right?
And then was like, I'm not going to do it.
Right.
And then,
right.
Yeah.
I think if you have a medbot, is an auto include. If you don't have a medbot, then no.
Okay.
Yeah. I can dig that.
Because you got to get that health back. You need that health. Whether you're operative or leader, Vader, you need that health back. But especially operative.
Do you still play operative Vader? Is a Royal Guard possible something to include there?
I've toyed with that.
Just to keep hits off of him?
I've toyed with it. I think it's possible. I don't know if it's effective, but it's possible. I think I still prefer Commander Vader, but Darkness Descends is a lot of fun. Like, getting him up there already. Again, sure. I had to spur once, and that was it. Which, like you said, Ryan, it's against a Rebel list. Against an Imperial list, be a very different game, and it'd probably bring a different list, but I'd also probably be able to do Darkness Descends in a different way unless he had more recon intels.
You go behind something. Yeah. You deploy behind, like, a line of sight blocker.
Did you have any fear, speaking of Vader, because he now actually has a suppression value? Did that factor in much?
No, because, again, he was in melee, and by the end of round one, he was good.
He like, shot it very often.
So. No, he cleared his suppression, I think the end of round one, he was out of melee, but then started round two, he got into it. But he had some suppression. Strict orders is it, and it was fine. It was never a big deal. It was actually only beneficial, never hurtful.
Three bravery characters are really hard to make them lose actions. Luke will maybe lose an action a game due to suppression.
Right.
I can see the urge to spur more often if you're further back than you want to be.
Right, sure. Yeah. And again, it's because I played Tauntauns, I didn't have to worry about that quite as much.
About the suppression game.
Yeah.
Yeah,
but it was interesting. It was definitely an interesting game. I'm glad I played it. I don't think I'm going to stick with Operative Vader unless the list demands it point wise. But very intriguing. The command cards are more interesting to me than Vader himself. But yeah.
Okay, that's fair.
I didn't take any pictures though. Sorry. Actually, I did, but I'm not going to share any picture of a digital surface. Sorry.
Sometimes they have really great battle maps. Well, speaking of our photos that Tim did not share, take a look at our Instagram. Where I will be posting models right before this episode probably drops of some works in progress that I'm working on. Will is currently finishing up my last bit of droids. He asked me for what the paint stripe color is going to be. So check those out on our Instagram at STABcast. Be sure to check us out also on the Facebook, on the Twitter. Rate us on iTunes. That's how we come back up in the rankings and the list. That's how you can find out that we are the fifth or sixth most liked podcast in all of Legion.
That's right. We're there. Hooray.
There's only four of us. War Corgi does mostly YouTube videos, so we don't count him in these things.
Whoa, hurtful.
Hold on now. But
He's a content creator.
That's right.
He's a video essayographer, but you don't normally download his things through iTunes, so it's fine.
Oh, you don't know my life.
Listen, I watch War Corgi. I'm not putting the man down. I'm not. It's like
we're also on the Discord, and by we, I mean me.
Yep.
And hey, so, I'm currently on the Discord right now. I sent you a message.
Yes, that's because we're talking on Discord. That's not fair. But we are on the Discord. We're at Stab, whatever your name you wanted. So it'd be Stabcast Tim, Stabcast Ben, Stabcast Ryan. Not Stabcast Will. I think he might have changed his name on there now. But
I don't know.
We're on there. I try to stream games a lot. Sometimes I don't win. Like I said, I've been away for a lot, so I've definitely slacked off on my streaming schedule. I was really keeping with it a lot for the Team League and for Invader League. I really have not streamed. I think I've streamed maybe one game, if that. So, but there's a lot of streamers that are doing all kinds of different games and casts and stuff. Especially at this stage in Invader League, you can be catching Legion almost all the time. So just be popping in and seeing who's streaming what. And I will try my best to keep up with that as well.
If you want to support our show more directly, you can check out our shirt shop at teespring.com/stores/stabcast. Also have a Gmail account if you want to drop us a line at swstabcast@gmail.com. Send us, guys, you guys have been really quiet. Send us some info about where you play. Give us some photos of your local play stores to put on our Instagram and communicate with us. We're always looking for show topics instead of just kind of reading the news feed or whatever thing me or Tim wants to rant about that Ben wants to attempt to moderate.
I try. I do what I can.
So, if there's something specific you want to hear, definitely let us know.
So, speaking of all the practice that Ryan was getting in, it's because he's going someplace. You know, it's a silly place. But, Ryan, where are you going?
We're going to go to Warfare Weekend in St. Louis. I've actually never been to St. Louis, so I will, just like all the rest of my travels.
I want you to throw your dice underneath the arch. Throw your dice under the arch. Play a Legion game under the arch, and that's it. That's all you need to do.
If I get a chance, I will. Would it give heavy cover? Or is it more of a line of sight blocker?
It really depends on which side of it you're on. It's light cover. Then while you're there, can you take some tauntauns and throw them in the river?
That's right.
Push. I mean, the river is right next to the arch. It's right there. Just sploosh. Just drop them in.
So
I like St. Louis. Ryan will only ever see the convention center. That's and all he'll I do. See it as he drives away. So, but there's actually really nice things to do there.
It's a neat city.
So I'm going to, Warfare Weekend should be fun. It's the second of three, maybe four grand championships. I'm not sure if the, at least in the States, if the last chance qualifier will technically be a grand championship or not. So we're hoping to punch our ticket again, I guess. It'll be fun. There's going to be some cool people there, and I can't wait to meet a bunch of people that I haven't met.
There's technically grand championships, and then there's things we just call championships. And, FFG likes to change the name every 6 months, so it's fine.
Yep, they do.
That's right.
You can come to the Knoxville Grade A Prime Championship.
Grade A.
Only the finest quality beef.
That's right.
Only the finest quality.
USDA.
That'll be January the 11th. It's like an RPQ, but it's not one. And you can still get a world's invite. So, that's still possible for the March 2020.
We have not had the great debate yet of who is TOing that event. I assume Ben will wrestle it from my hands again.
Me.
All right. No one show up to this
that's
event.
Right. That's right. No, 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 no.
Tim knows how to organize a party. He does.
I could.
He may not invite you to it, but he's
going to organize it. It'd be an automatic of drinking at this Legion event, but that's fine. For a dry store, it'd be odd, but that's fine.
Every instance of the Pierce keyword in your list is just 10 extra points.
That's right. I'm going to bring, kind of like Will made the joke about me last time with a label maker. I'm going to bring a label maker that's just going to have blank labels. I'm just going to cross out Pierce on all of your lists. That's fine.
It would be delightful. So, but that happens in January. Tim, where are you going in February?
No, this is also January.
This is also January?
Yes. Yeah,
it's also January.
Yeah, January is going to be fun. Yeah. We're going, Ryan and I are going to LVO in Vegas. It'll be quite fun.
Yeah.
I will eventually book a hotel and we will be there. I look forward to losing and then going around Vegas and then popping back in occasionally and seeing how everyone else is doing. But it's going to be huge. I forget what the total number is at right now, but it's quite a large event.
They've expanded like twice.
It's going to be not only a big event, it's going to be a fun event. I think everybody's looking forward to it, and it's got quite a reputation for being a blast.
Tim, can you get Ryan out of the convention center so he can see Vegas?
I don't know. And I don't know if I'm allowed to bring some of the entertainment in from the streets into the convention center. But if I can, I will. So that's fine. And I'll just have a parade going around the Legion tables. But look at this. Look at this. Distraction.
Just go collect those little cards from those guys on the corner of Vegas. He always have cards. You just give them to Ryan. Like, here's your trading card. That's right.
These aren't the promos I signed up for.
They're not the promos you signed up for.
I'm just going to come into the convention center every couple hours more and more broke and more destitute. Ryan, hey, man, can I just borrow a... You got a couple of those tokens or something that I could pretend they're lottery chips or poker chips or something? Or just come on, man. Just let me in. Let me do it.
Sir, this is not a poker chip for our casino. This is definitely a command token.
They don't know what command tokens are. They're fine. When I go to cash it in, but like, what's that? That's an operative token. That's worth $5,000. Thank you.
So that is LVO. That's happening at the end of January, start of the February. And that just leads us into the greatest bit of gaming for us, which is Adepticon, happening in March at the end.
Favorite convention of the year.
I love me some Gen Con. I do love me some Gen Con. But I also... Adepticon is just different. I mean, one, you don't have the press of flesh. I mean, there's still 15,000 people there. But they are really there to game, and that is what they're up to. Mm-hmm. And everything else is
Adepticon really that big? Is it 15,000 people?
I'm pretty sure it was 15. Maybe I may have done some math wrong. I will go double check that number.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's not right, but that's okay. I think it's still a lot of people. It's still a great convention. But it's the convention that I don't get judged for going and just playing the competitive events and not leaving. Like Gen Con, when I do that, people say you're weird and you're missing out on the Gen Con experience. At Adepticon, that's fine. We can just sit there and play the tournaments and no one judges you.
I have not been to Adepticon yet. Maybe this year. Probably not, but maybe this year.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, I'm way off. Sorry.
Yeah. I figured it's like probably 1,500.
No, it's nearly 4,000.
Okay.
Well, I will say that one of the great events that Will and I had at Adepticon 2 Adepticons ago was actually leaving Adepticon to go with Scott to go buy a model in Chicago because Scott had left something at home. Well, yeah, Adepticon, it's going to be good. It's the end of March. It's lots of fun. If you've not made plans for it, you definitely should.
So the news, is this the time to talk about the news?
This is where we normally talk about the news.
The news.
All right.
There's no news.
There's no news still. No news. Nope.
There's no dewbacks. All right, that's the news.
That's right.
But anyway, yeah, it has been a really slow news cycle since Gen Con. We've had a few tidbits. But yeah, it seems like Star Wars Legion news is like feast or famine. We either get all the things and none of the things. Now, granted, because we got this article a couple weeks ago, that probably means we'll miss two news articles in the time between we record this and we release this.
Yeah, they'll release something on Tuesday of next week, and we'll release on Wednesday.
Oh, yeah.
It is the nature of our beast.
But yeah, we got specialists. Specialists are neat. Rebel trooper specialists, stormtrooper specialists, and then we got their captains spoiled. So I think we had an article earlier in the year that showed the two new weapons that each faction is getting, but now we've got what the non-heavy weapon options are.
Yeah,
and they are pretty. They're pretty cool. So let's. I actually want to start first with the specialist. They both give a gear slot. They add a model, and they have a free action that gives a dodge token for the Rebel specialist, an aim token for the Imperial specialist. And then they also gain a surge token. It's a free action, but it is tappable.
It's aim token or surge token.
Oh, it is an or. You're right. Or.
Yes.
I can't read.
It's why I put the photo in the notes.
Yes, it's true. I'm looking at the
one, the Rebel photo is just the one I'm looking at. Somehow got really big.
It's still got the word or on it.
the word or is still
there.
You're right. you can get a dodge or a surge token or a aim or a surge token for the Imperials. They are a 4-point upcharge from the standard body.
Yep.
For your rebel troopers or your stormtroopers. What are we thinking?
I think I like them. I think having that extra little free action is nice. Like you said, it's tappable, so you got to tap it. But I mean, you still get an extra body in there plus that extra action. Plus, the upgrade slot is neat, too. I don't know if I'll use it, but it's neat.
The upgrade slot feels strange.
Yeah.
I would have paid 15 points for the ability without the upgrade slot. So I'm perfectly fine also getting the upgrade slot.
That's fair.
And mostly because I am a Veers player. Mm-hmm. And so being able to refresh that with Veers' 3-pip is fantastic. Yep.
As a Veers man, when I see their tappable, I'm like, oh, that's no big deal. That's fine.
We'll definitely think
the Stormtrooper, for that very reason, is, at least right now, stronger than the Rebel variety.
Sure.
But the flip side of that is I also think the Rebel dodge token, at least depending on when that unit activates, is more impactful than the... Because the nimble than the.
I was going to say, yeah. The nice thing, you get to keep that token when you spend it. We can't keep our token.
So the thing I really want to actually try out is putting just one of these guys in a list and burning it on a turn where I run covering fire.
Mm.
So he can get a dodge token himself, shoot, and then give a buddy a dodge token and start that train. Because usually that train has a bit of a false start because the guy who shoots doesn't have a dodge token himself, and so then he's the one who gets
right up.
But you no longer, like with the double gear slot, you no longer have to make the choice if you're going to go gear heavy between recon intel and environmental gear for 5 points. Yeah. You can get scout one and unhindered.
And I do love that. And now, granted, you're at 19 points.
Yeah.
I mean, or 20 points. But I still like it. For 20 points more, I'd do it.
Yeah.
I could also see you throwing this guy if I go back to my style that I played last year where I wasn't running a ton of Z6s, and I could just go for a more defensive, consistent, but slightly cheaper Rebel Trooper to where I'm getting them to stay on the board maybe a little bit longer, but they're not dealing as much damage. It's an interesting upgrade from the Rebel side. And I think it's cool for the Imperial side. I think for the Imperials to really work, though, I think targeting scopes needs to take another point hit.
Yeah,
Yeah, absolutely. You're not wrong. And maybe that's what they're trying to push us towards is, oh, look, you could add targeting scopes. You get all the precise, but...
So, yeah, if you could roll a stormtrooper out, a specialist out with recon intel and a targeting scope...
You can't have recon intel twice, right?
No, you cannot. You can only take each upgrade once.
Never had to ask that question before.
I'm wondering sometimes, do I take the surge token for the defense?
Yeah, I thought about that.
Stormtrooper, yeah.
I thought about that. I can see it. Real hard. Especially if, like you said, if you're a Veers player, if you're getting an aim from somewhere else, yeah.
Yeah, I think the Rebel card doesn't need to say or surge token. I don't think it's that big of a deal. I think it is a big deal for the Stormtrooper, though.
Yeah, it is a big deal for them. I mean, mostly because your Rebel Troopers are already surgy on defensive. I mean, at least it gives them the surge to offense at once. I mean...
Yeah, that's if you roll it.
That's if you roll it. I mean...
Okay, so we're feeling like kind of meh on these guys.
I wouldn't say meh. I'd just say unsure. Unsure.
I like the idea of going double for cheap, you know, upgrades, cheap gear. I do like that idea. And mm-hmm. I do think you make targeting scopes, what do you say in our last podcast? I say three. I said you brought it down to 3 points. I would definitely do that in either recon or that in environmental gear. Mm-hmm. In a heartbeat, I'd do
mm-hmm.
that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I also think it depends on where maps go. I don't see a lot of area difficult terrain, which is something I think we need to see more of on tables.
Yes.
And we've been banging the drum on that on this podcast since nearly day one.
Yeah.
But tables have definitely changed, and it's such an interesting concept because it's so player driven on what tables look like. It's not FFG can't give us a decree and say tables have to look like this.
Right.
It's up to what we decide to play, and
I mean,
those flavors will come in and out of vogue. I still think it's safe to say nobody is taking the grappling hooks, though.
Nope. Nope.
I saw a list not that long ago that had grappling hooks, and guess what? They were never used.
Yeah.
Was it enemy of the podcast? Because that sounds like something.
No, it was someone online. I saw it. I'm like, oh, everyone's like, oh, neat. Those are points you can spend. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's something you can do.
All right, so moving on from the specialists, we've also got some capitans.
And I like this one more, I think, for both of them, in part because you're getting that ability upgrade.
I don't, and we'll talk about that. This will be a fun discussion.
So here's why. The training slot upgrade...
Yeah, it gives you a training slot, and then it gives you a leader model, which I don't think that matters.
Yeah.
It's the same point cost, and then, Ben, what can you tap it to do?
When you activate, you cannot remove suppression tokens or be suppressed during this activation.
It's interesting.
It is that one place where you're like, okay, Jin's going to do a thing. Like, you remember the Jin's ability where you can basically, I'll do whatever I want this turn. Next mm-hmm. turn, we're going to pay for it. But this turn,
right?
Let us complete the things.
Does that mean you even skip your rally step or roll dice, but they don't do anything during your rally step because it's when you activate?
Yeah. Now, I do have a question of when do I tap this card?
I think it's as soon as you put your face up or your token next to the unit or nominate that unit to be the next active unit.
I think so, too. Because
that's when you activate a unit and then you rally it. So it's not like you can wait and see the result of the rally roll and then choose to tap it, which is very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And so if I can't be suppressed, I'm assuming that means I can't be panicked either.
I would say you can.
Doesn't say that. Yeah. So
I would say you can. Because there's a difference between suppressed and panicked.
So that's kind of where it gets interesting. But I think the reason you think it's cool is the same reason I think it's not. I have a Jin 3 pip that does this.
Oh. See, that's cool and I like it for that one moment when I need it. No, for me, it's actually the other upgrade. It's the training slot.
You can do some cool things with a training slot. I'm not personally a huge fan of paying points to pay points. So I'm paying four extra points for a training slot, which I have to pay points to put a training on. Now, there's going to be a couple key units where you can put this. Don't get me wrong. I think Stormtroopers with Overwatch are going to be sick. What trainings are y'all looking forward to putting on?
Offensive push.
Yeah, push is quite good.
Looking for 4 points, I move, get an aim, and then I shoot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, I love that thing.
Yeah.
So for 8 points, you move and get an aim. Yeah.
Right. Which is worthwhile for them because they're white dice. And they are precise. I mean, it gives you better reroll, gives you action economy. I mean, really, I like it. I really
That's
do.
Fair.
Oh, yeah.
I guess I haven't thought about offensive push because it's not out yet. I tend to not eval things because I'm not playing the TTS all that often. So
oh no, that was in the article.
Yeah.
No, but yeah, I look at these things in a vacuum, and I probably shouldn't. You're probably the smarter player for looking at that.
And I'm sure there's going to be a defensive version as well. I think, but I just don't know what that's going to look like. But
I mean, I'm imagining it'll probably just be a dodge token, which the rebel players will think is sick.
Right. Absolutely.
Here's the one problem I have with this. This Rebel Trooper Captain, and maybe the FFG will remedy it, maybe they won't. That first line of text, Rebel Trooper only.
Mm-hmm. I was thinking I would love to have this guy on a Stormtrooper or Snowtrooper.
On a Fleet Trooper, these guys would be bonkers.
Can you imagine this on a Snowtrooper? Like a... Oh my gosh. Having offensive push on a Snowtrooper would be great.
Oh, absolutely. Oh, I move. Grab this. I move again. Now I have two, and then I shoot because, you know... Oh, and that's probably why you can't do it.
Right. Yeah, or just the Snowtrooper's ability to not be suppressed.
Right.
Because that's when Snowtroopers start to be less great, is just as long as they've got some suppression tokens on them. So I think they're cool cards. I kind of wish they were in other places and not just my Rebel Troopers, but I 100% get it. I 100% get it.
I can definitely see that. I can definitely see that. But I will say what I really like, and it's something you can't visually see on a podcast, I love the models for this, for both sides. Oh,
the models are great. Yeah. The models are fantastic.
I mean, the Stormtrooper Captain looks like he's just casually hanging out there. Like, he's got, it's an interesting, very placid pose from what you normally get from a Stormtrooper.
Yep.
Like, he's got like a model pose right there. I mean, yeah. Then you're getting the Athorian, I mean, which Tim and I both love in Athorian.
Oh, that Athorian shotgun is going to be so good.
Bello. Yeah, that makes me want to play as a rebel for a moment. Almost.
It's a scatter blaster. Kata.
It's awesome.
Wait. Are you talking about the captain? Hold on.
No, we're talking about the heavy weapon.
I was going to say, because the captain's not an Athorian, you racist.
No, he's an Ishitib.
That's right.
Ishitib, yeah. Thank you very much. You can see that in the pictures.
And yes, then, but I didn't know if you knew. Maybe. I don't know how well educated you are, how culturally sensitive you are.
Look at Tim trying to low key lore check Ben. Yeah. That's not going to come back to bite you on Monday night at all, Tim.
It's not going to bite you at all, Tim.
What's Monday?
Aren't you guys playing a Star Trek RPG on Mondays?
Every other Monday.
It's quite hilarious to try and just shout out Star Trek things like, I do this. You can't do that, Tim. Why not? Because they're at war with each other. Damn it. Okay. Let's try something else.
Because the Federation doesn't murder people at whim, unlike the Rebels or the Empire. Yeah. Stopping Tim from being a murder hobo is going to be real.
You made me head of security.
It's why I hashtagged it, Make Trek Not Wars, Tim.
Does not compute. Sorry.
I'm super excited by those guys.
I don't know. The specials and the captains are cool. I can almost see, now that I'm thinking about it, 20. I don't know that Hunter's worth 10 points, but sometimes you just really want an aim token on that Z6.
Yeah.
And being able to throw Hunter on there as your to chew through some IRGs or some multi-wound units. Tauntauns, looking at you, bud.
I was going to say, you can just throw on against some Tauntauns. You'd be all
right. So the Rebel officer is 20 points, right? Or 19?
19.
So is having one more courage value worth 5 more points?
Yes.
But you don't get the upgrade slot.
Yes.
Because of the Inspire one?
In certain places. It's not even the Inspire one. It's just the extra courage. Because those guys can go on fleets and they can go on snows.
This is true.
I think in certain circumstances, and technically they're cheaper on fleets because they're more expensive. So it's, you know, the model cost is a little less. But since these are traded Rebel Trooper only, at that point, you're paying about the same cost to throw a Rebel Captain with, like, Endurance to get the same kind of Inspire on self and the extra pseudo-bravery. The extra clear, anyway. It's not quite as good as just flat-out extra bravery. But I don't know. They're cool models. I kind of don't like the active ability of the Captain just because I think it pulls a trick out of Jin's playbook and makes that less valuable because not everybody can have it.
I can understand what you're saying there, though.
Why she should have been an operative.
Yeah. And Jin needed to be... Like, I feel like she's finally in a good place with her new point cost. I think she's more manageable there. But now that you're going to start giving her abilities out to other places, I don't know. That's my only holdup.
The Captain I see being very handy when you have your suppression bubble still, your commander's still alive, So it's going to take four to panic you. But you do have the two suppression tokens on you. And so you still get to do the double actions that you need.
Yeah.
Taking the point, moving the thing, doing this other thing. And 15 points plus an upgrade slot availability. Like I said, I'm going to put offensive push. I mean, maybe it's something else, but offensive push is cheap for 4 points, and I'm likely going to want to move anyway. The action economy is worth it. Yeah, it's yes. great. It's
hey, listen, black dice, man. You get black dice with a red die in there. All right.
Bonk.
Yeah, I love it. Love it.
Stormtroopers are good in melee.
I also think Overwatch is going to be killer in that slot.
That's also true. I mean, yeah, absolutely. Overwatch would go very well there. As we started with today's episode, talking about dice, Tim and I have had very odd occurrences of swinginess. We have.
Yes.
I mean, Lord knows, I've had games where I throw nothing but crits. Ryan has complained about that before. Or games where I throw nothing. Everything is blank.
Yes.
And I didn't realize there were that many blank spaces here.
Yes.
So recently at a tournament, I had left my dice box at home. I didn't mean to. I repackaged something. I think it ended up in my X-Wing bag. I'm like, okay, let me see what I can do with this. I'll just use the dice app. I downloaded it years ago so I could play the RPG with Ryan, because Ryan didn't have a dining room table for sit around. So we just sat in his living room rolling dice on our phones and lying about it.
Yep, that's what y'all did.
Yes, we definitely got two successes.
Yeah. Double triumph, wow.
Look at, I only rolled green dice, but there they were.
That's right. Weird.
That's a meta joke that maybe two people are going to get.
Right. But it's fine. You people get it, and we love you for it.
That's right.
So I played with the dice app. Will was starting to play with the dice app. And I think we need to have a conversation about it. Because I'll be honest with you, I think I'm going to use the dice app from here on out.
So I'm also, I like using the app. And before we even get to like the numbers of it, aesthetically speaking, I like rolling real dice better.
Yes.
But I know, Ryan. We'll give you your platform in a moment. But I don't like using the dice app on my phone because it's too small. But I do love having an iPad, which I do, and using it on there because it's nice and big, like a dice tray, really. It's about dice tray size, give or take a little bit bigger. And so it's easy to roll. If your opponent wants to use it, it's easy just to flip it around and let them use it. And that's fine. And it's just right there, easy to see, wham, bam, it's quick. You don't have to, am I reading that symbol? Like, boom, just, it makes it go a lot quicker, and you can't
get... If you're having trouble reading symbols, Tim, we have to have a different conversation.
Thank you. You can't get mad at the dice app. Like, it's fair. Ben and I joked about this last night. If Harvey Dent was a real person and Two-Face was real, he would use the dice app. Because it's fair. And I said, if there's some kind of way you could just work up a Halloween costume that somehow involves Two-Face and the dice app, like, I don't know how. That's a really obscure reference, like, Halloween. Yeah. I'm going to wear that to Gen Con one year and see if anybody gets it. I don't think they will. Be very impressed. But it's fair. It's fair.
We've joked about this before. We know that the tolerance and the actual manufacture of the dice is not great. It's not Vegas quality. Alex Davies has said that on podcast.
Right, right.
And so I do know that I have got some defense dice that are bad. Well, like I have traded out dice. I mean, I've rolled dice on my own table. I haven't salt tested them, but we joked about doing that one day.
Yeah.
We'll I know in X-Wing, I had green dice that were bad.
Yeah.
I could not get a focus or evade if I wanted to.
And here's the other thing, too. On the psychological level, it's even if they are statistically okay, it's just there's always that seed of doubt in the back of your mind of like, but what if they're not? But what if my dice are bad? Whereas you can't do that with a dice app. It's like, nope.
You can.
No, you can't. No. What are you going to argue? But what if the algorithm's wrong?
The dice.
Well, not there's you can a computer by itself cannot randomly generate a number. It has to have parameters on how it selects and oscillates.
I'm not going into that conversation. You're wrong. The dice app is even.
it approximates even to the absolute best ability that I don't think live dice can pull off.
Yes.
Maybe yes, maybe no. I think here's my thing against the dice app. I like rolling real dice. I sue me. Like, I play a tactile game. I don't play this on online that much. Like, I like to get out there, and the clatter, it's satisfying when you can throw your hands down when you have a bad game. And I like actually using dice. I don't like the dice app because a lot of times you can't really see what your opponent's doing. It's easy for your opponent to manipulate, because the dice app does have a functionality, and it's normally a good thing, where you can change the dice to any side you want, and you can do that rather quickly. Mm-hmm. And if someone is using it on their phone on their side of the table, like, you make a good point with the iPad, Tim, but yeah, not everybody's going to do that.
Right.
For me, it's if I can't really see it, if they can manipulate it somehow. And I would really be anxious to give this to one of our more tech-inclined friends and see how easy you could break that thing.
So I think if someone is cheating on the app, you have bigger problems.
Yeah,
and two, that's true. All your complaints are easy to fix, because when I played against you, I just put the phone in the middle of the table.
Yeah, I just put it down
so you could see it, and I was like, tap, 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 yep, tap, tap.
But not everybody I've played against who's used the dice app has been as kind and as courteous as
you. Well, just ask them.
Yeah, just ask them.
I know. The dice app, it can still be swingy. I do think it rolls better than table dice. I think you guys would agree with that. That's why you're using it.
Yes.
Because it's fair. And I do think it slows the game down too, and that's one of my bigger complaints.
No, I think it makes it go faster. You can save presets on the, so when you have units that are throwing like weird combos of dice, like Tauntauns are throwing all kinds of dice, and when you're throwing lots of rainbow colored dice, you can save it as a preset and just go bam, boom, done.
I don't know. If you get a printed die pool, then we both like I try to roll dice and you try to load in and roll your dice. I'm pretty sure that the human player with real dice will do it faster.
Nope.
Especially with aim tokens and rerolls.
Nope. I still, yeah.
Okay.
All right. Because those people who insist on rolling on the table, those mm-hmm. dice scatter everywhere. Yeah,
they make
such a
mess.
We knock stuff down. Like, they do make a mess. I mean, they really do. And also, right, I think it sounds much cooler when you go to roll things and you hear noises, and it's like.
So Ben is like a small child, and he wants the keys that jingle and the lights that flash.
Yes,
No. Exactly. You're the small child because you want the tactile sensations.
I do.
Yes, wait a second. Hold on now.
So what we're hearing is I'm the backwoods fundamentalist.
Yes. I'm the progressive new church with my rock and roll.
Right. Like. And I'm the empire did nothing wrong. So that's all that matters. So
all right. Before we split, and God, no one cares about your sounds, Ben. Before Ben starts making even more sounds and we have a schism of the STABcast,
that's right,
I think it's time for us to call this one a show. As always, thank you for listening to us with your paint time, your drive time, whenever it is you bother to listen to our voices. And until next time, I'm Ryan Slowoski, reminding you to roll real dice.
I'm Tim Hannon, reminding you the dice app is fair. It's fair!
And I'm Ben Fowler, telling you, you roll what you need to get that success, buddy, is all I'm saying. That's right. Don't cheat, but go with the dice app.
Roll what you have to kill the Tauntauns. That's
right. Good night, everyone.
Have a good night, folks.
Good night. Or good morning. Well, your choice, really.
Yes. It really. I mean, what if they're starting to it's nearly noonish.
I tend to listen to this podcast on my way to work. And, you know, it's like, it's morning time podcast.
Shower time in the morning is actually when I catch it most of the time. I mean,
I'm too brain dead by the end of work to listen after work. So. I'm stopping. So I played a game against someone whose name I've now lost his name. I had it written down. I apologize. But great opponent.
Wow.
You actually brought him up last night, but I don't remember who it is. Like,
Tim, if you want to think about that, I can crack a joke at Ben's behest while you figure that out.
Go for it. Yes, please, go ahead. It's fine.